Good evening and welcome to worship at Martin Luther. We're glad that you're here tonight to gather around God's Word and Sacrament. Tonight, we begin our Holy Week observations as we celebrate Palm Sunday, as we remember how Jesus rode into Jerusalem on a donkey to be our Savior, to take our sins away. What a wonderful celebration this is. The order of service is printed out for you in your worship folder. We'll begin with the opening dialogue that's printed on page 3. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you. Dear friends in Christ, for 5 weeks of Lent, we have been preparing for the celebration of our Lord's Paschal mystery. Today, we come together to begin the solemn celebration of Holy Week. Christ entered in triumph into his own city to complete his work as our Messiah, to suffer, to die, to rise again. Let us remember with devotion his entry that culminated at the empty tomb and follow him with a lively faith. United with him by baptism, we share in his resurrection and new life. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Let us pray. God our Father, we remember how Jesus entered Jerusalem and was welcomed as king by those who shouted Hosanna and spread palm branches in his path. Accept our praise and listen to our prayers as we rejoice in our triumphant King Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We sing our opening hymn, Ride On in Majesty. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins to God our Father, asking him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this, I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us and has given his only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. We praise you, O God, for the great acts of love by which you have redeemed us through your Son, Jesus Christ. As he was acclaimed by those who scattered their garments and branches of palm in his path, so may we also always hail him as our King and follow him with perfect confidence, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated. Today's first lesson is recorded in Zechariah chapter 9. Here we see the prophet Zechariah, hundreds of years before Jesus would live on this earth. We see him prophesy what Jesus would do on Palm Sunday. Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I will take away the chariots from Ephraim and the war horses from Jerusalem, and the battle bow will be broken. He will proclaim peace to the nations. His rule will extend from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. This is the word of the Lord. Today's second lesson is recorded in Philippians chapter 2, and this will serve as the basis for this evening's sermon. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of the Lord. Please stand for the reading of the gospel. Today's gospel is recorded for us in Mark chapter 11. This is Mark's account of the triumphal entry into Jerusalem. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you doing this?' say, 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here shortly.'" They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, "What are you doing untying the colt?" They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." This is the word of the Lord. You may be seated for the hymn of the day. That's three stanzas from All Glory, Laud, and Honor.
Thank you.
Grace and peace are yours from God our Father, through your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The basis for our meditation this evening is today's second lesson from Philippians chapter 2, which was previously read, so I won't read the whole thing again, but I will read just verse 5. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. This is God's word. Brothers and sisters in Christ, last year for Palm Sunday, I preached over at Trinity to a practically empty sanctuary so that everyone else could follow along at home. In my sermon introduction, I mentioned how weird the whole situation felt. And it did feel weird. And we were a couple weeks into the weirdness. But I think it's safe to say that at that point, none of us knew just how weird the next year was going to be. And here we are, a year later, and things are still kind of weird, aren't they? We're not back to normal yet. We still have to take precautions. People are still getting sick. And we have plenty of people who are still engaging with worship at home. But last year, just like this year, we had these words from Philippians chapter 2 included in the Palm Sunday service, as they are almost every year. And they were applicable then, and they're applicable now. And actually, I think that it's as important as ever for us to have this reminder this year. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. Now, we're certainly going to spend some time today talking about how Jesus' mindset demonstrated itself in his actions. But before we get to that, I think it's good for us to take a few moments to think about how having a Christ-like mindset might show itself in our actions. And actually, the Apostle Paul gives some pretty clear direction about that in the verses just before our text. In verses 3 and 4 of Philippians chapter 2, he wrote, "In humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others." How many times over the course of the past year haven't we seen people who have been looking to their own interests and not to the interests of others? Seen that quite a bit, haven't we? And we certainly saw that with the pandemic, didn't we? I think we saw it on both sides when people approached regulations and how to do that and everything. On the one side, you had a group of people who was acting as if they were saying, you know, I'm going to do whatever I want to do, and I don't care how it makes anyone else feel. And on the other side, you had a group of people saying, you know, everyone else needs to do exactly what I think they should, and I don't care how they feel about it. And then probably most of us were somewhere caught in the middle. But as we've had to wrestle with that, and as we've had to deal with people who approach things differently than we do, I think it's probably safe to say that it's been a struggle for each and every one of us at times to humbly understand and look to the interests of others. And that's been a struggle, not just when it comes to the pandemic, because that's kind of how we approach everything, isn't it? Our sinful nature always wants us to put ourselves first. Our selfish, sinful nature wants us to look to our own interests and not to care about what anyone else thinks or feels. But when we do that, we are not giving other people the care and concern that we should. And even worse than that, we're not living the way that God wants us to live. You know, this tendency that we have to put ourselves first is sin, and it makes us worthy of God's wrath and punishment. And that's why it's a good thing that we get to celebrate Palm Sunday. Because on Palm Sunday, we see a humble servant. See that humble servant, our Lord Jesus. And as he rides into Jerusalem on a donkey, he is doing exactly what needs to be done to save us from our sins and to make us right with God. And that's a really good thing. It's a good thing for us to focus on today. So let's take some time to think about the mindset that Christ Jesus had that moved him to be our Savior. The Apostle Paul wrote, "Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage." You see, this past week when I was reading through Mark's account of Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem, there was something that jumped out at me again and again and again. That is that Jesus is in control of this situation from beginning to end. The story starts out with Jesus sending two disciples ahead of him, and he tells them in miraculous detail exactly what they're going to find. And then just about everyone in the story does exactly what Jesus tells them to do, exactly what Jesus wants them to do. And then, amazingly, Jesus miraculously manages to ride an unbroken colt into Jerusalem. Jesus is in control. And there are a number of ways in this story that we see Jesus' divine power on display. But how does he use that power? He uses it to ride into Jerusalem, where he would be betrayed and arrested and killed. See, Jesus didn't use his power to his own advantage. He used it for you. He used it to save you. You see, instead of using his equality with God as something to be used to his own advantage, Jesus humbled him, made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. You see, Jesus humbled himself so much that not only did he not use his divine power to his own advantage, he stopped making full and frequent use of it for a time. I mean, just think about it. Jesus Christ, who is equal to God the Father, humbled himself so much that he chose to be born as a baby who would need to learn how to walk and talk. Jesus humbled himself and chose to become a human being who would get hungry and thirsty and tired. Of course, throughout this whole time, Jesus possesses all that divine power. He's true God. But he set it aside. And even though he had that power, he chose not to make use of it most times. Because most of the time throughout his life, he lived just like a normal human being like you and me. Why would he do that? He did it for you. Because in his humility, Jesus sought to serve you and to save you. And as if all that weren't enough, then Jesus carried out the greatest act of humility of all time. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. You see, Jesus knew what was going to happen when he became a man. He knew that there were going to be people who would hate him and reject him. He knew he would be stabbed in the back by a friend who would betray him. He knew he'd be arrested and falsely accused. He knew he'd be beaten and publicly flogged and then crucified. He knew what he was getting himself into. Even still, this servant humbled himself to save you by laying down his life to take your sins away. Now, of course, Jesus, the true Son of God, would not remain humbled forever. Paul wrote, "Therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord." See, God wouldn't leave his Son to decay in the grave. No, he'd exalt him. He'd raise him from the dead. Then Jesus would go on to prove his resurrection, his victory over death. He would ascend into heaven where he is seated at the right hand of the Father, ruling all things for your good. And one day he's going to come back, and he will judge all people. And all people, whether living or dead, whether in heaven or in hell, are going to need to confess the truth that Jesus Christ is Lord. Some will do so reluctantly. Others will do so with shouts of praise to our glorious, exalted Lord Jesus. And all of this is done to the glory of God the Father. You see, there's a reason that this week is a big deal. There's a reason that it hurt so much to miss these gatherings last year. It's because this week is what the Christian life is all about. Here we see our Savior, who humbly serves us so much that he is willing to literally go through death and hell to save us from our sins. And then we see the Father exalt his Son, glorify him, raise him from the dead, victorious over death for you and for me. This is a glorious thing. It is something worth celebrating. But now is not exactly the time to celebrate quite yet. Come back for that next week. Because today we see a humble servant, our Lord Jesus, riding on a donkey, riding into Jerusalem to be the exact Savior that you needed to take your sins away. So let's spend some time today reflecting on him, thinking about all that he's done for us, his humility, his resolve, his love. Let's thank him for all that he's done for us. And then, out of thanksgiving for how our Savior humbly served us, let's let that motivate us put some humble service into action in our lives. After all, remember the very first words of our lesson for today. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. With every interaction that you have with people this week, go into it asking yourself the question, how can I humble myself to serve this person? Every time you interact with one of your family members, or one of your friends, or someone at work, think, how can I put their needs ahead of my own? Can you imagine what the world would look like if everyone did that? It'd be amazing. But forget about the world for a second. Can you imagine what it would look like if each and every one of us here made a point to put this into practice consistently? That'd be amazing too. We could make a huge difference. The lives of the people around us would be so much better and so much happier. So I want to challenge you this week to, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but to the interests of the others. And that starts right here. And right now, with us in the church treating one another with love and respect. But it doesn't stop there. Because as we go forward from here and go out into the world, we take that with us into our homes, into our workplaces, into the community. And we have a tremendous opportunity to bless the people around us. So let's make that what we do this next week. Let's see how we can be a blessing to our neighbors. After all, we've seen what a blessing that humble service can be. Because we see the humble servant, our Lord Jesus, riding into Jerusalem on a donkey to be the Savior that we needed. What an amazing thing. What a wonderful thing. Let's give him thanks. Let's give him glory. And as we do that, let's seek to humbly serve the people that God has put in our lives this week. As you go and do that, you know that God will be with you, and God will bless you, both now and forever. Amen. Please stand. The peace of God, which goes beyond all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. We now confess our Christian faith using the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. This is the time in our service when we would normally offer our gifts to the Lord. We won't be passing the plate just yet, but there is an offering plate at the back of the sanctuary. You can drop your offering in there on your way out if you would like. We continue then with our offering hymn. That's two stanzas from When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. For the prayer of the church today, we will use the responsive prayer that's printed out for you in your worship folder, and it'll also be on the screen. We do include a prayer for our member Marlon Kluge. Marlon had a stroke this past week, and will be rehabilitating from that, so we keep him in our prayers. Our prayers will then conclude with the Lord's Prayer. We pray. Lord Jesus, like your disciples, we have been loud in our challenges against those who are not loyal to you, and yet we have turned out to be disloyal. You trod the way of love without flinching. We hesitate to tread it at all. We have been afraid of the pain and suffering which your love brings. But it has done us no good to follow the easy way, for it has made us less than the Christian men and women you want us to be. We must follow your way of love, even though it is hard, for it is the way to true eternal life. Just as you rode into Jerusalem to fulfill God's promise for salvation, so come into our lives to keep us on the way of salvation. You did not waver on your way to the cross. Forgive us when we waver on our way. O Lord and King, give us the courage to stand by you in the hour of grief and not to turn away. Keep us loyal and devoted to the end, always open to the Father's will and to the needs of others. Lord, we ask that you would bring healing to your servant Marlon, who is ill. Relieve his distress, strengthen his faith, and grant him recovery according to your will. And now hear us, Lord, as we bring you our private petitions. Dear Savior, as we walk with you this week toward Calvary, keep us focused on your purpose for coming into the world and on our calling to spread this wonderful message of salvation. Hear us for your mercy's sake. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good and right that we should at all times and in all places give you thanks, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty and everlasting God. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who willingly died under the curse of this world's sin, so that we may live forever in the light of God's blessing. Therefore, with all the saints on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your holy name and join their glorious song. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
true body and blood of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, will strengthen and keep you in the true faith until life everlasting. Depart in peace. Your sins are forgiven. Amen. Please stand. Lord God, ruler of heaven and earth, cleanse our lives and purify our hearts so that your Son, the King of glory, may come in and lead us rejoicing to your heavenly city, where with the Holy Spirit you live and reign, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Seated.
Good evening.
Once again, welcome to worship at Martin Luther. We're glad that you're here today. We'd invite you to return to worship with us again soon. We'll have plenty of opportunities to do that over the course of this coming week. Those opportunities are listed for you in your weekly news. I encourage you to pay attention to those. We do have services Maundy, Thursday, Good Friday, both in the afternoon and in the evening. Those are two different services. We'll have an Easter vigil Saturday night and, of course, Easter festival worship next Sunday. So make plans to join us for those services as you're able to do so. There are other announcements that are printed for you in the weekly news. I encourage you to take a look at those. As you leave today, you won't be ushered out, but I would encourage you to keep a bit of distance as you do so. If you're not going to take your service folder with you, feel free to throw that away in the back. I'll be available in back to talk if anyone would like to. We do have an update from Nina Lutheran School, so we can watch that video now.